It's a great pleasure and honor to chair the last session of this fourth Heidelberg Laureate Forum. My name is Gerd-Martin Greuel. I'm a retired professor of the University of Kaiserslautern, not far from here. And the first speaker of our last session is Professor Heisuke Hironaka from Japan. He received the Fields Medal in 1970 for his achievements in algebraic geometry, in particular for the resolution of singularities. He will explain, I guess, what resolution of singularity means, so I don't go that, but I just like to mention that this was considered and is still considered as one of the deepest results in algebraic geometry. I don't want to go very much in the curriculum vitae. You can all read that in the nice booklet. I just like to mention two exceptional things which impressed me. First of all, he is a member, was a child among 15 in his family. And so that was also exceptional in Japan at that time. And the other exceptional thing is when he received his Fields Medal, he was so popular in Japan that he even was used for advertisement of products, I guess, for cameras. So in Tokyo, you could see Hironaka looking upon you. And I think that's right, very exceptional for a mathematician. To be honest, to say he was also considered as a very nice looking man at that time, like a movie star. So that helped also, I guess, for advertisement. In any case, today he will talk about the resolution of singularities in algebraic geometry. Please.
Thank you very much. I cannot say that I'm a really good mathematician, but one thing I know is I'm a terrible speaker. to some extent, I have an excuse for that. You know, mathematicians, like a music composer maybe, just sit down and quietly most of the time and occasionally come out and talk with other mathematicians, but only some way nobody understands what we mathematicians are talking to each other. I will talk about blowing up, and one time I was talking with my friend very seriously about blowing ups. Then the lady on the next chair said, "Can you stop talking about blowing up?" Well, we did, quietly, continued. Well, the subject I like so much that I was willing and I am still willing to spend entire life just for this. And it's good because I know quite well that I'm not one of those genius who change subject at least three times for a life and do good things in each completely new subject. That I cannot do. But one thing I promised my wife when we had a golden anniversary 5 years ago, that I will continue to do this work and put it in the, try to put it in the best form and write it in a book form and dedicate to her. But the trouble is that I can't win over my age, I'm only 85, but nonetheless, it's not a young age. And so since five years ago, my wife kept asking, did you finish your work to be dedicated to her? So I said, okay, one more year. But then the next year she asked, did you finish? I said, 6 months more. And next time I said, 3 months. Next time I said, 2 months. And then keep saying, maybe in 2 weeks. I continue that for 20 times. And my wife stopped asking because she knows the answer. But I am serious, and I think I'm close to the end of this work. So let me tell you, what is resolution of singularities? Well, if you look at this picture, there is, you can find a singularity. What are they? I'll show you. Something called cusp, something called node, something called tuck node, and so on. I tried to make this very hard with a wire. And I came up something like this. It's bended badly, but nonetheless, it has no singularities. And its shadow looks like this. So I realized that resolution singularity is something, some maybe weird shape or whatever, but it can be made into a shadow of rather nice looking or meaningful. By the way, I tried to extend this to my name, Heisuke. But I couldn't because wire was so hard. But anyway, I end up with he. That made sense. Well, this is actually the entire story of resolution of singularities. In fact, resolution of singularities is just to make cook up something in higher dimensions so that the given shapes or sometimes dynamics is a shadow of something smooth in the higher dimensions. If you make a dimension higher, then you can make even nicer ones, at least locally everywhere. So this idea can be explained like this. I bet some of you are good with Japanese, but or Chinese, doesn't matter. But what I'm trying to say is, in order to eliminate or make it nicer, you need polar coordinates. the polar coordinate has a center, and the directions shooting out from that point. So focusing this point to the singular point, which you want to eliminate, you make operation like this. You lift lines in some proportion to the degree of turning. Then you get something like this, sliding in a children play in the playground, and slide down like that. And this operation is like a microscope pointing singular points. And you can see the singular point, the how singular it is, or how to replace by something with no singularities. So this very simple operation is used everywhere many, many times. Just to show you example like this. You have something called node. If you're running on a highway like this, then of course you must stop here, possibly avoiding some accident. But if you apply this, then this direction corresponds to this, and this direction corresponds to something higher than that, so that in the end you have no singularity we call node. So, and that works also what we call cusp. Like this. You know, if this is highway, you are running on a car, you should stop here. Otherwise, you should crash out. But if it's not bad cusp, then by applying this, just it becomes like this. In other words, this, this point is replaced by the pole. And if you have a shape, something tangent to the pole, and look at the shadow, it looks like this. So this is the way you go backwards, elimination of singularity called cusp. So these are very simple things, but nonetheless, it's very, very fundamental. For instance, when you have a shape like this, you want to get the, maybe you have an equation defining that, but you want to get parameters, how to describe it. For instance, this one you start here like this and go up, or this one goes around and go around, and so that's called a parametric presentation, because that tells you a change of the speed or the even looking at the signature of somebody, it has a lot of singularities, cusp, node, and so on. That's, of course, important to distinguish from other signature. But nonetheless, if you want to copy it, and you, if you copy as it is, as it looks, then it's not really exactly what it was. Because the signing, you have a speed. Some parts very fast, some parts very slow. And people can distinguish or check the speed and you get a better distinction if somebody wants to misuse your signature. Well, that kind of things help the resolution singularities. Now, you may have something, some kind of a shape with a locus of singularities. It looks like this. Every point is a singular point. The way you attack that is you take transversal section like this and move it. As you move along the singular locus, you blow up each point like this, the crossing point. So basic process is very simple and universal for resolution of singularities. For instance, if you have this, you do that kind of things, then you get emitted like this. And you can see that precisely with the equations. Well, when I say equations, why the equation is so good? Because it's algebra. When you look at the geometry with singularities in higher dimensions, just equation doesn't exactly tell you how singularity is. For instance, my friend drew a picture like this. And I had one more equation, and I asked that one of the four equations doesn't fit any one of the three. And high school students had very hard, but they couldn't find it. Because this abstraction by algebra is behaves quite differently, unless you are very familiar with it. But what is good with algebra is you can manipulate the equations algebraically and see what you can get. And sometimes in the process, you don't know what's happening with the geometry. But in the end, you get what you want. In other words, that algebra is powerful in doing and trying to get to the end without knowing what you are doing on the way. And that is the power of algebra. Of course, you know what you are doing with the equation, just you don't know what's happening with the geometry. And There is one more problem in dealing with singularities, that to analyze and find the process of resolving singularity, you need equations, a local coordinate system, and equations. But the equation doesn't always extend. You get its own singularities as you extend it. But it's connected with different equations. So when you are dealing with equation, technique becomes local. And because of the localness, you have many powerful techniques you can apply. But the only problem is when you apply the technique here, it may, and also here, the two may not match around this point. So you need some kind of global setup that local process matches, or you want to find all the possible local ones and all the possible local process and see which one matches here, like that. So that again requires algebra, the set of equations we call ideals. And you have powerful use of algebra in dealing with ideals rather than particular system of equations. When you deal with global problems, well, when I just want to say one thing. I was lucky that I had a good teacher by the name Oscar Zaritsky at Harvard when I was a student there. But I was more lucky in some way having a very close friends for student this Oscar Zaritsky had. And one came from Germany, one from, I don't know, somewhere in United States. That's a big country. And one from England, and this shortest one is me. But you learn somehow in some deep way something important from your classmates. In some way, in some instances, in some occasions, it's much more than you learn from the teacher. So I was very lucky, and I'm very thankful for those three geniuses, along with somebody, some dumb person there. Now, I can say I finished my talk, but the reason that I'm still continuing on the resolution of singularities, because it becomes much more interesting when you are working with finite fields. It's like a calculator. I use some prime numbers, maybe large, but but it must adjust so that 1 divided by 3 times 3 is not 3, 1, like that. But that kind of thing is much deeper in the character P, namely over finite field. But amazing thing is, to me it's amazing, is that well, first of all, that in character 0 or over, say, complex numbers or something like that, you can you have if you have an equation, you have a very simple process. Namely, you just look at the multiplicity of this point and say it's d, and then you can easily find the differential operator of degree or order d minus 1, and you apply that to the equation, then you get something locally smooth. And this smooth one has an amazing property, which I call maximal contact. Just by differentiation, we get maximal contact. And the maximal contact one is, this itself is smooth. It contains all the points as bad as this point. And the resolution of singularities of this given hypersurface is essentially reduced to the data induced in this lower dimensional smooth thing. That process I call ambient reduction. Ambient space is reduced to lower dimensional things. And that is done by simple differentiation. Well, then immediately you come to the question of differentiation of a finite field. But actually, it wasn't difficult because in algebra, what's important is not the differentiation itself, but rather Taylor expansion or Parseval expansion of equation using differentiations or repeated differentiations. But if you look at this expansion, the coefficients doesn't make sense anyway. It may become zero, but it never becomes it gives you a pole or something or up to infinity. So forget about so-called partial derivatives and so on, but always look at Taylor expansions. In other words, you look at dummy variables, you add it, expand it, and in terms of the dummy variable, and you look at the coefficients, that is a differentiation. So you can use the differentiation very much. But still, there is a shortcoming. That is differentiation kills so many polynomials. Anything with the exponent high power of p characteristic, then it becomes zero. In other words, it kills so many. So you get something quite new. That is, You see, here that I'm saying that what you get by ambient reduction looks like this, some idea and marked number, and what you are interested resolve singularity is this the set of all the points multiplicity bigger or equal to b, and this number b is decide the size of the singularities. So in case of zero, it happens that if you choose good differentiation, immediately get induction on the number of variables or dimension of the ambient space. But so what you can use all the differentiations and you get compose graded algebra. Now, I want to say that when you have some higher dimensional object with singularity, rather complicated at a point, then how you look at the singularity, you take all the arcs, one dimensional arcs, shooting into that particular point in question, and each one has some contact with a given one, so you have contact order. In other words, you take all the arcs with contact numbers. But that's an enormous set. But if you think a little bit, then that the totality of the so-called infinite near singular points, that means contact arcs and contact numbers and all that kind of things, there are infinitely many of them, can be proved to be equivalent to one finitely generated graded algebra. If it's finitely generated, you have only finite number of generators. So you look at, you start working with the generators. Because it's a finite number of them, each one is a polynomial or something like that. So there is a way to attack the singularity in this, again, put it in this form. But what is the difference between infinite field, character zero, and finite field? Is that in finite field, because of differentiation kills the some important part of the equation. So unlike, say, over complex numbers or rational numbers, you don't have any one of them having order one defining smooth, locally smooth object or locally smooth ambient space. So ambient reduction becomes complicated. Equation defined by any of the generators of a finite field, itself has a singularity, and it becomes complicated. But it turns out the it turns out still we have a finitely generated good algebra And so you know what to work with. Just look at each generator or choose good generators and analyze that. And that equation looks like always the generator look like looks like this. Some parameters, good parameter, but with exponent power of the characteristic. So as soon as you take a differentiation, it goes away. And plus something higher order terms, extra terms like this. Every generator, every one of the generators looks like this. So the question is how you handle this kind of things. But still, differentiation is the best known technique. And so many people try to lower the order of this without affecting anything on this. And if multiplicity of this becomes lower than Q, this exponent, then you are done. But unfortunately, that technique miserably failed. So I look at the problem in a completely opposite way. Why not I make order of this bigger and bigger so that it doesn't bother so much the equation, original equation with this term itself. And that what I call leverage, local leverage up. That means I make multiplicity bigger there, but in such a way that maintaining this term and by the process I eliminate non-p power terms in here. But we don't have to worry about it so long as its multiplicity is becoming bigger and bigger with respect to the original resolution process or program. So if you do that, then you can eliminate all the p power terms and in the end, the whole thing is p power. Then you extract the piece root of the equation. Then multiplicity drops. And that's what I call make a leverage up on this and up enough. And in the end, eliminate all the p power parts and take the piece root of the whole thing. Well, then eventually order becomes one, and just like in characteristic, and you can use it for ambient reduction and by induction on the dimension of the ambient space. So why it works? Why is that, how it works? If you apply differentiation, say alpha has non-zero, alpha is a term, component prime to p, well then it kills this part. And it has derivation of this, which is higher, because this cannot have a p power term of the same multiplicity like this. It's higher order. So you pick up a term like this and you apply the differentiation. Now, this kind of equation has two numbers. One is homogeneity degree in the sense of the algebra Q, algebra P. I said I have a graded algebra by using differentiations, just simply differentiations. So you have, if you take a finite number of base of differentiations, then you get only finite number of derivatives and so on. That generates graded algebra, and graded algebra has homogeneous terms and its degree. Call it homogeneity degree. But homogeneity degree, by differentiation, it goes down as much as the order of the differentiation. So it goes down like this. But multiplicity itself drops only as much as the order of differentiation. And if you differentiate this one, then you get a partner as a factor like this. So then you apply the differentiation on the other part. Then even that drop down the homogeneity degree this much. But if you add these two, in other words, if you take a product of the two, so that you get something like this, then its homogeneity degree is, you see that this plus this, it becomes something, this degree is bigger than this exponent Q, so it's, if you take a product and make this product plus something else, and you can take out and know that it has higher homogeneity degrees, so by permissible transformations, selective transformations, always multiplicity goes up. So set it aside, take out and set it aside. And you keep doing that, eventually this remaining terms are all p powers, so that the whole thing can be replaced by p powers. So that's the proof. It works. Only problem is, again, globalization of this process, because localization, locally, you have a coordinate system chosen nicely, and differentiation chosen well in order to do this leverage up and whole exponent down. That kind of thing, you must know how to piece them together. In other words, you find some kind of coherency theorem. And fact is, we can do that. And that's the end of this proof. And I guess it's the end of my talk.
Some questions.
Yes.
I'd just like to ask, what about writing up this proof? Is it with like the book for your wife, or is it done?
Well, my wife stopped asking. So, but still, actually, I'm quite confident that I have a proof. As soon as I found this process of leverage up and exponent down, this wasn't there in the calculus zero at all. But now it's there.
Okay.
And the only question is how to globalize. And that's a little bit tricky, but I can do that.
Okay. Thank you. There was a question.
I'm an old friend of Hay many years ago, and I enjoyed this talk. I learned from it, but maybe some members of the audience would be helped if I made some comments. There is a very close analogy here, which if you think hard, you might see between what is described here in context of number theory and prime numbers and so on. And he, of course, used differentiation. Those of you who are more used to doing calculus, if you're in applied mathematics or you're dealing with other situations, very often you have things called P and Q, which is not the same as here, but correspond to momentum and distance. And there is a kind of duality there. And in all those theories, it is quite often possible to play one off against the other and increase one strength as opposed to the other strength. And even if you're doing physical systems, one force may be stronger than another force. So there actually are very close analogies with what Professor Hironaka was describing, and large parts of mathematical physics. And I think that analogy is not is important and may help one side to understand the other side. I haven't written it down. My wife hasn't asked me yet, but I will try.
Okay. Thank you. There's a question. Please go with the mic. Oh, we are here and then there.
Hi. Japan has produced so many world-famous mathematicians working in the field of algebraic geometry. Historically and culturally, I'm wondering what contributed to Japan's strength in algebraic geometry, and also what inspired you to study the subject early on?
Well, I don't know if this is the answer to you, but I was a good friend of Iwasawa, who was a professor at MIT when I was a student at Harvard. And he said many times that difficulty of number theory is that you can't shake prime numbers. You know, prime number, big prime numbers. Nowadays, somebody tried to get a patent for the 300-digit prime numbers or something like that. But anyway, it's very difficult to find. And more serious problem is you can shake the prime numbers. If you add one by mistake, immediately start decomposing it. So Iwasawa was kept saying that there must be some way of even heuristically or whatever, shake prime numbers. And I'm using this calculus P resolution for resolution of arithmetic surfaces, surfaces or algebraic geometry defined over integers. If you apply calculus zero theory, which is very well canonically explicitly done, and then you have finite number of primes remains, which you can see when you localize by to pass from the integers to rational numbers. But those, if you look at resolution of the neighborhood of that P fiber, calculus P fiber, that hints something, some kind of what kind of geometry you can get as neighborhood of prime number. And that's why I'm serious about this question first keep asking me from by Ibasawa. And I don't know how successful I will be, but I don't know how many years I can be around. That's going to be my dream or whatever you may call it. I will work hard, see what happens.
Okay. There are one, two more questions or so. Here was first, I think, this one. Yeah, please. Could you pass the microphone, and then there was.
Well, for sure, my wife wouldn't mind if I start doing this theory, but my boss, that is also a woman, would really, really, really be uninterested in me starting to look at these singularities and how they solve this globalization problem. For sure, in some of my incursions into the modeling of fluids and looking at the perturbations that they cause when you have certain displacements, the only thing I can say is that globalization is possible and it's noticed, but yeah, for sure my boss will kill me.
I think you are right.
Okay.
That's very interesting.
Okay. There was a somewhere. Yes, please.
Thank you for a nice talk. I have two questions. First one is, do you want us to write you and ask Kenneth Paskin you about your book, or you are going to write it anyway?
Well, when I give it to my wife, I must put it in a book form. Otherwise, she wouldn't take it.
And the second question, do you interact with other field science? For example, do you have inspiration from physics or like that?
Can you translate?
Whether you have inspiration from physics for your problem?
Yeah, if I could live another 10 years, I would do it. But I'm afraid 10 years is very expensive. I'll be 95.
Okay. Okay. I think we are over time already, so we should stop now, and please, the next speaker come to the stage.